will do is that I'll briefly review all the essential concepts of last time. And you please stop me, I mean, it's my purpose was not to go fast. I just went automatically accelerated. So what I will do is I'll review all the essential aspects I covered last time. And let me know. Okay, so what we started was with the what I said is ki, to discuss topological defects we need three essential ingredients. So topological defects. They exist in some physical system. So this is a physical system. So they exist in a physical system. That physical system is situation, physical space. So physical space is important to specify. They exist in a physical system which exists in a physical space. We denote it by M. We denote it by M. And for simplicity, we are taking it to be full space in the beginning. For simplicity, we take it to begin with. To begin with. Say R2 for two-dimensional problems, 2D problems. And R3 for 3D problems. So what this means is, the topological effect I could be discussing would be, say, cosmic state, in the cosmology. Then it is actually full universe, because you are discussing physical system. It has to be full universe. So it will be R3. You could take a condensed matter system, helium-4 film, film of helium-4, a film of liquid crystal. Then, in principle, liquid crystal sample is small, so it should be some small space. But then I have to discuss what happens in the boundary. So that's complicated. Necessary. So to start discussion, we are taking full R2. So my helium system or liquid crystal is infinite in two dimensions or in three dimensions. So to begin with, we are taking implicit. So that is the first ingredient. First ingredient is physical space. The second ingredient is the order parameter space. Meter space. S. So for helium case it is S1 and for ferromagnet case S2. And then the most important thing is the order parameter field. We denote it by phi of R. And this carries so this phi of R is a prescription of the order parameter at each point of space. So if a helium-4, then we have helium-4 system, then that means superfluid condensate, which is a complex scalar field, wave function. If this guy at each point, stuff like that. So what we can do is, the phi of R is actually a map from M to S. It's a map. It's a continuous function. Continuous function. And continuous function in the context of topology, we call map. So that was the first statement we wrote down. That phi is actually a map from M to S because it prescribes at each point of M a value in S. S is, for example, S1 for the case of, let me remind you, S. Oh, wait. Covered 2 minutes. Let's not worry about it. So this is what it is. Okay. Then we said ki, the way we discussed topological defect was, we said that you take particular order parameter field configuration and you deform it slightly. And see whether, so we considered a configuration on in physical space which had a binding number 1 configuration. And we said that any way you deform it, is binding number 1 doesn't change. That was the essential argument in showing that there is a topological effect. Right? That means the deformation of these maps are important. We have to consider deformation. A given map is a very specific configuration. will give example. This could be one of map. One map could be this. This is my order parameter configuration. For helium 4, it is the phase of the complex order parameter field. Here complex order parameter is field. Or for ferromagnetic condition, there is spin in that direction. And another, this is phi 1. And the phi 2 can be everywhere like that. But in the between is rotated. Slightly rotated. Something like that. This is phi 2. So this phi 2 is different map than phi 2. They are both along order parameter field configuration. And this phi 1 is phi 2. And so far, I have been assuming phi 1, phi 2 are continuous in entire time. Which will not be true. Because in physical defects, there will be topological defects. Topological defects precisely are the points where phi becomes singular. Order parameter becomes singular. But right now, just consider this. Then we define the concept of homotopy of map. When do you say that phi 1 is continuously deformable to phi 2? When you make statement continuously deformable, you make slight changes. Little changes. What this means is phi 1 is changed to something else, to something else, to something else, ending up in phi 2. So that means it is a family of maps. So this implies family of maps. Family of maps. They can call, denote by capital phi S of R, which is now, so such that, and then let's take S in interval, closed interval 0 to 1. So all numbers between 0 to 0, 1 included. Just some choice. You could take 0 to 100, no big deal. That's it. Such that phi of 0 R is my phi 1 of R map. Phi of 1 R is phi 2 of R. And phi S of R for S in between, phi S of R for S 0 less than S less than 1. In between values. For the boundary point 0 and 1, these are the things. For in between, these are intermediate stages. Intermediate map denotes maps from M to S for intermediate stages of deformation. So you make very slight change in going from here to there and you call it phi 0.1 R. More different phi 0.2 R. That's it. So this is the meaning of continuum. When you call it a continuous deformation, you notice that the phi actually has an argument R which denotes a map, but has another argument S. So we write phi S R as phi R S. Now it's a function of two arguments. So this phi is actually not just mapped from values from domain of R to S to the order parameter space in S interval also. So phi is a map actually from M cos I into S. That was a very important realization. Phi has two arguments, so there should be two spaces. R, let's call it R. R is values in M and S is values in interval I. So this is interval I. S belongs to this interval. This is the unit interval I. S belongs to this. Little S belongs to this. And this is the order parameter. So I know I'm again going fast, but I think 2 times going fast is probably overall slow. Okay. But because this is completely now these steps are clear or any more clarification? Now it's a very simple statement. So what we say is that when you have S equal to 0, then so phi of R, 0 is phi 1 of R, and phi of R 1 is phi 2 of R. For each value of S, each fixed value of S is simply the map from M to S. For each fixed value of S in this interval, it's just simply map from M to S. element which is representing the family, and that varies continuously, the maps vary continuously. They don't have a jump. That's the definition of continuous function. So what this means is this family is continuous in the argument S also. It's a continuous function of R. When something is continuous function of R, what this means is you change a little bit R, the value of function doesn't change much. That's also changes very little. That's the meaning of continuity of function. We'll have more precise definition, but that's it. You, f of x is continuous, you change x a little bit, f of x changes very little. That's the meaning. Now what I'm saying is this map, family of map, is continuous in the argument S. So if you change S little bit at any point, then the map which it represents from M to S also change very little. That's the meaning. So let me make a statement. The continuous deformation just means that this family of map is continuous in argument in M and S both. Is an equivalence relation, we say. So, homotopy. So, we denote it. If phi 1 is homotopic to phi 2, we denote it. If phi 1 is homotopic to phi 2, we denote it. Yes. Phi 1 is homotopic to phi 2. Yes. Equivalence. This is actually equivalence relation. Homotopy is an equivalence relation. It's an equivalence relation. Equivalence relation. So phi 1 is homotopy to phi 2. Phi 1 is homotopy to phi 2 implies phi 2 homotopy to phi 1. And phi 1 homotopy to phi 2. Phi 2 homotopy to phi 3 implies phi 1 homotopy to phi 3. So when you have equivalence relations, then you can have equivalence categories. Categories in the equivalence relation. So there are categories of maps. So we have can be continuously deformed to each other, but by definition, none of the maps here can be deformed to this. Belonging to different equivalence classes. we have entire physical system, and say helium 4 system, and if I say that my angle of the order parameter field is continuous everywhere, there is no vortex. How did we locate a vortex in this thing? Or in two dimension case, how do you locate a vortex point? We consider a loop. We call string defect, a string vortex defect for superfluid helium. We consider a loop L in physical space. We consider a loop in physical space. Space was, so it's two dimension, space was R2. In physical space, R2. Considering infinite system. The loop was, the space was infinite. But we didn't bother about the order parameter field or the phase of the condensate everywhere. We said consider a loop and simply consider order parameter field here. So this is my phase represented on this. Completely continuous function on this. Completely. Because topological effect is not on the line, not on the closed. So it's completely continuously defined, this function. Theta is well defined there, everywhere. That was enough. That was enough. We didn't do anything more than that. We just considered this and then we said because it's a binding number 1 configuration. Then we did all kind of things, like we said you deform the loop slightly and all kind of arguments. That you deform it, binding number 1 remains to binding number 1. So you make the loop smaller, smaller, eventually theta becomes discontinuous somewhere. So theta is continuous here, but somewhere down there you find that theta is varying like that at a point. So it is discontinuous. And that's the location of singularity. But this is not where to say. So that means if this is enough for us to locate a topological effect. This is enough. So subspace in the vortex string case is just a loop. It's a circle, let's say. So here x is a closed loop, loop L. We can take it to be circle. Take to be a circle F1. So take it to be circle. So we say that in R2, I want to locate, or R3 also, if I have a string defect, I just take loop S, loop or circle S1 and consider order parameter field varying on that continuously. So here now my map will be from S1 into the order parameter space. This will be my map. That's important. So let me write this. Now we are making important space. So this is now basically new thing beginning. So now let me know. Okay, forward. And for vortex defect. How we locate a string defect? We located a string defect by saying you consider a loop closed path, and around the closed path you have some order parameter field varying, and it has a winding number, non-trivial winding number, and then we concluded there must be a string defect enclosed inside. So if it has a two-dimension case, it will be point defect. In two-dimension, it has three dimensions, a string. But the enclosed has to have some kind of topologically invariant mean. I mean, you can enclose, one can enclose a vortex in two dimensions by a closed loop L, which is a subcircle. So we have a vortex here, and I draw a loop L around it, and I know it's enclosed. I know it's enclosed. Yes. Because if I, the only way this point can go outside the loop is by crossing the loop. Okay. So it's enclosed, properly enclosed. But in 3D, a point defect cannot be enclosed by a loop. In 3D, a point defect cannot be enclosed by a loop. So this is my three-dimensional space, and this is my point defect. And I say this is my loop. In what sense I am enclosing it? Because I can just shift the loop up, and it is not enclosed anymore. There is no invariant. And we know you are allowed to do all kind of topological continuous deformation. So shifting loop, shifting point, everything. So the moment I lift it up in the z direction, it is not enclosed anymore. There is no invariant meaning to enclose. But if I have a string defect in three dimension, a loop will again enclose it. But a string defect in 3D is again enclosed by a loop. So I have a string in 3 dimension, and you instead, so remember, string has to be either infinite or a closed loop. So either this way, so this is my, let me draw it this way, dotted curve. Or if this is a string loop like that, let me draw a string like that, then again a loop. So loop L. If there is a string defect, which is either going to infinity or forming a closed loop, this closed path always enclosed it. Because no way to remove the string outside this until you cross it. So a loop is enough to trap a string or vortex in it. Vortex in 2D, or point defect in 2D. So the conclusion is, point defects in 2D and string defect in 3D can be identified by considering maps from S1 into S. So phi from S1 into S, this S is always the order parameter space, and S1 is a circle. So you simply consider map from a circle. When I say circle, basically I mean closed loop. I'll discuss it. Closed loop L. It doesn't have to be circle, just closed loop. Circle is immature. So we want to track a point defect in 2D or a string defect in 3D, then you consider map from a circle or a loop into S, and that will give you all the information. This is not going to be enough if I want to identify a point defect, monopole defect in 3D. To identify fine. point defect in GD, then what you do is you enclose it by closed surface, completely enclosed. And then you, this is what we did with monopole. You consider order parameter field configuration on the entire surface of the sphere. Entire surface of the sphere. And just by judging quality of that configuration on the monopole, on this surface of sphere, you try to deduce whether there is a monopole inside. And this is trapped now. This is enclosed. Because this is either inside or outside. There is a meaning to inside and outside. This is a topologically invariant meaning of inside and outside. The same way as topologically invariant meaning for these guys as being string defect being inside the loop or outside the loop. There should be topologically invariant meaning of inside and outside. Then you say it's enclosed. So a closed surface has this meaning. So to identify a monopole defect, so here, so for point, so here, we consider map from S2 into S, where this is two sphere. It doesn't have two sphere, it can be a deformed surface with closed surface. We'll consider that, we'll discuss that, two sphere. So this is basically summary of until this point of last point I didn't cover that much in this paper. Now let me see if this part is needs to be further explained, because these are very important concepts and actually difficult concepts. They may look simple, but so is this part clear to everybody or should I explain more? Any good part? Let me explain this here. Completely covers this. Completely is wrapping. We can see that we call it wrapping. deformation possible. No deformation. Continuous. Possible. Which makes M constant vector. Say M star vector on S. So this is right now pointing ADD outward, right? I can ask you, I mean I can give you a configuration which you can make constant. So this is my S2 in physical space and I give you this configuration. It's still varying. So you see, this is a vector on a surface of a 2 sphere which is generally varying upward, right? But it's still varying in various manner. Now there's no big deal in changing it and pointing it everywhere upward. You can automatically see, right? As I showed in a simple configuration. You can very smoothly make everywhere vector small changes. It will cost you energy, but finite energy, little bit energy. Okay. Make everywhere and make it constant. This can be easily deformed to a configuration which is completely constant. Can be easily deformed like that, right? There is no way you can do this for this. This pointing radially outward. If you have radially outward configuration, you can see it's radially outward. You try to deform it like that, somewhere there will be singularity. You will not be able to deform it. You cannot deform that one to this. This looks reasonable, I mean, it's not a proof, but it looks reasonable that this kind of configuration cannot be deformed to a constant configuration. It looks reasonable. Doesn't look reasonable. Right, that's it. I mean, it looks unlikely, right? I mean, this is very easily seen, but that you must be having a hard time visualizing it. All I am asking you to find it hard. Let me just draw it here so you understand what I mean. This is the configuration. Radially pointing outward everywhere, magnetization vector. And I am saying this to this, not possible. This to this, not possible. Because you try to make it vertical, what will you do here? There will be point where it is exactly opposite. What will you do there? There is a point where it is exactly pointing up, opposite way, which what will you do? There will be singularity somewhere. This to this is possible. This to this is not possible. And from that, this was the kind of configuration we considered. So, this cannot be made into constant, that was enough for us. And by that, we said, if you consider smaller surfaces, this nature of the configuration, then it cannot be made. So, the fact that it cannot be made into constant, made it a non-trivial configuration, this was called a binding number 1 configuration. Binding 1. I will call it to wrapping. Wrapping. Binding 1 configuration on S2. We had considered binding on circle. This is a generalization of that. Now this is wrapping on a surface of a sphere. And this configuration has a binding number 1 configuration. So this binding number 1 configuration, which is wrapping on the surface, retains its character of winding number 1 configuration as you shrink this sphere, as you consider smaller surfaces. This wrapping part does not change. This is when we argued when we were talking that magnetic monopole is a topological effect. This is what we argued at that time. That part does not change. And hence we concluded that there must be a region point somewhere where again you will find, because if the fact that this wrapping doesn't change, maybe I should remind you of the argument of circle. On circle, when you have a binding number 1 configuration, just simply think of circle first. Circle. This is a simple theta which is varying from 0 to pi. in equilibrium is constant, and hence we computed somewhere down there in the configuration where theta is mixed between singular. Same, exactly same thing for many people. This theta is varying all over the surface of a sphere. So if you shrink the surface a little bit, you still have it varying all over this sphere. This is not possible, constant is not possible. So you keep doing it and you eventually find your center is varying all over the place. It becomes singular. This magnetization vacuum becomes singular. That is how we identified magnetic monopoles when we discussed monopoles. The bottom line being is that to identify this magnetic monopole, we had to consider a surface of a two sphere. A loop was not enough. Surface of two sphere. That's what I'm saying. So to identify magnetic monopoles, so let me just make this point again. Final statement. So for a string we said already. So for point defects in 2D and string defects in 3D can be identified by considering map from S1 into the order parameter space. This order parameter space. Okay. Phi from S1 to S. Now to identify point defects in 3D, we need to consider maps from S2 into the order parameter space. So phi from S2 into. This is the clarification, and now what we should realize is alternative statement to these things. What this is, because we knew their point defects, we knew their string defects, and we have gone through the machinery of how to identify it. But let me just give you an alternative statement for all what I have said. And by the way, there are more generalized cases. We have not discussed in this way how to identify domain walls, how to identify externals. But let's just stick to this. So let me put an alternative statement for all this. Way of saying the same thing is, let me write this statement. So consider maps that is continuous function. From loops, which will mean circle for us, and closed surfaces, which will mean S2 for us. some order primitive space here. And consider maps from L to S. And see if it is homotopically non-trivial. If it is, if M is R2, if M is R2, you say there is a point effect here. If M is R3, then you say there is a string effect here. So M is important in that. M tells you what is the structure of the effect. It's a point effect in 2D, it's a string effect in 3D. So done. Okay. So your turn. Now you consider, so this implies this is vertex in 2D or string in 3D. Then again you have M, you take the closed surface S2 and consider map again into order parameter space S. Maps. If this map is homotopically non-trivial, you simply conclude. And S2 you cannot put in R2 anyway. It is only in 3D which matters. S2 you can't embed. You can do it discriminant, that's not very good. So and this is in R3. The moment you, this map is homotopically unfair, you say there is a point effect. Point effect. Just for picture. So our job is reduced now to considering S1s and S2s embedded in M, considering arbitrary order parameter space maps. And seeing if these maps are homotopically non-trivial, if they are, we could start concluding defect. What defect geometry still will be? This is the machine. This is geometry. So if this part needs more explanation, well, this is the essence of the topological defect. You understand this, then this is a long way. Any questions about it?
Circle, and now deform it like this, sharp.
chart. Anything changes in my argument? You see, this is a smooth, beautiful differential deformation. Smoothness is maintained. But anything changes in the argument?
Derivative
is not defined. Where did I use derivative? Delta theta is 2 pi, it is just required theta to be continuous, not differentiable. I just need the delta theta should be 2 pi, it is simply required. Around any closed path, a theta which is well defined, a single value, will change by 2 n pi. It never requires that the path should be differentiable. So the sharp angles are allowed, no problem. Right? These also okay. So I can also consider zigzag, zigzag, this kind of path. It's also okay. Any closed path is okay, whatever be the shape. Any closed path is okay. Irrespective. So any shape is okay. Any shape is okay. But you clearly see that you can't define derivatives on it. Derivatives are not defined on it. But derivatives. But not needed. Derivatives not needed. Needed to conclude invariance, topological invariance. Topological invariance of binding number. I have been emphasizing this. The reason these are topological defects is because we are only interested in continuity properties, never differentiable properties. Even more dramatic is monopole.
Very precisely defined when if you have taken any introductory course on general relativity.
considered a small region which looks like a small region of Euclidean space. Region of Euclidean space. Rn. So a space which is n dimensional. So a space M which is n dimensional manifold is differentiable or smooth if at every point of that M there is a small region which looks like a small region of Rn. That's enough. It's called Riemannian manifold. So this is actually essence of general relativity. This actually amounts to the thing that gravity can be okay. I mean, locally every region is flat. So you see, the surface of a sphere is such a smooth manifold because you take any tiny region. It's curved, surface is curved. But you take a very tiny region and blow it up. A tiny region is still curved, you see, blow it up is still curved. But you make it tinier and tinier, the curvature basically disappears. Tinier and tinier is more and more flat. So it just looks like a surface of R2, region of R2. So this is diffusible manifold, but that one is not. But you take this surface and make it a cone here. Or just a cone itself. This region, P point, simply never looks like that. Because always a cone. It's always a cone. A cone has a vertex which near that is never looks like. So this cone, this point P, if you take this region, it never looks like. Never looks like a region of flat space, a region of R2. Because however small you go into that, there's still a cone of finite angle. It never looks like flat. Never looks like that region. So it's not differentiable at that point. This manifold is not differentiable at that point. The point is that whenever I was drawing the various curves and surfaces in trying to show you that the winding number or wrapping number for monopole is topologically invariant, I was just habitually drawing smooth things. I never drew sharp corners. But you realize that arguments should not change if I draw sharp corners. Because only thing required for topological defects is continuity property, never differentiability property. If somewhere in my argument I require differentiability, then it cannot be called topological defect. That means the defect is not invariant under any deformation which only retains continuity property. It also depends on differentiable property. It cannot be called, it will be called differentiable defect. It cannot be called topological defect. Topological defect beauty is amazingly robust. The only thing you require is continuity property. What this means is for topological defect to exist, or these binding numbers etc. to be topologically invariant, I must consider spaces which are not differentiable manifolds. X need not be a differentiable manifold. So in order that topological defects are genuinely topological. So for example, a winding number is topological invariant. So in order that topological defects are topological, for example, winding number is a topological invariant, we must allow some space X to be a non-differentiable allowed to be general manifold, general space, which is not differentiable. But saying not differentiable is not a property. It's just saying that this property I don't need. But what do I need? I have to tell that. I don't need this property, but what do I need? Can it be anything? See, space, what is space ultimately? Space is a set of points. You take a set of points and you start putting structure on there. So I said, on the set of points, I don't need differentiable structure, but do you need something? So what do we need? So what actually we need? What do we actually need? We know what we need. We need the notion of continuity. We don't need differentiability notion, we need notion of continuity. We do not need notion of differentiability.
Definition you can define.
So let me start putting this statement. So what we will say, we will have a set of points and we will say, so you can start the set of points, but you need to have properties. When you say these properties, then you put a structure on it. You put some other further structure on it. So this is called topology. You have a set of points and you give a topology to the set of points. That's what it means. A topological structure. Oh, let me first mention this for a bit. Okay, let me write this. This is important. So I have written it down. The idea is that we will discuss very general notions of topological defects and continuous function, etc. That is to emphasize the robustness of topological defects. How robust is the concept of topological defect with those general definitions? But in practice, the spaces we will deal with are sometimes differentiable manifolds. But if not differentiable in manifold, because I showed you, we are allowed to do all those surfaces. At least they are metric spaces. Metric spaces, where distances can be defined, right? This space, topological space, doesn't even need to have a notion of distance on it. You know, that's the minimum space thing you would think you will need, right? The notion of distance. That distance function is something, you know, is always possibly definite, and distance between 1 to 2 and 2 to 3, sum is larger than distance from 1 to 3. That's a distance function. You would think if you want to define continuous, you should have a different Latin notion of distance. You don't need that. That's called metric spaces. So you need, even that is a richer structure than this. I don't even need that. You don't even need that. But there is some notion of what is called nearness. This clearly you need some notion of nearness, right? If I have to define continuous function, there will be some notion of that. But so the spaces we will be dealing with will all be metric spaces. So in that sense, not an epsilon delta definition, but a generalized definition of epsilon delta would work there. But important thing to appreciate is that topological defect definition doesn't even require that structure. We deal with those examples, that's a different question. We will discuss general, because it used to bother me, you know, why such a rich mathematical structure you are using if you don't need it. But it's very important to realize the power of this structure. It makes you confident about your topological defect. We'll discuss general notion of topological defect. Of topological spaces, continuous functions, etc. etc. So that one fully understands the robustness of the considerations underlying topological defects. Even though most spaces we will deal with, most spaces we will consider will be smooth manifolds or at least metric spaces, at least topological structure in the spirit of what I am going to do. So, topological structure.
Why this number is limited 29 by only 20
so that you will see.
Or
because, okay, I mean,
why
like
this number is important?
When I give definition, become clear. It has to do with subsets of A. The topology is defined by giving subsets of A. How many different subsets you can have?
Okay.
But it's not just that. See, number of subsets is number of subsets of a set in the personal power set. So, how many different subsets of a set you can have is 2 to the power n. Is there n elements are there, 2 to the power n is the number of sets you can have. This is bigger than that. Because you have a total number of subsets, you can make a different selection from it. Different selection. I'll give you a definition, then you will do it. So, this different topology, actually, topology concept is very interesting. I mean, just give a discrete set of points. And topology actually is when you consider these different sets, it tells you which point is. I mean, clearly, for continuity, you need to have a concept of which points are close by, right? You consider function from that. So, if function varies little, if this argument varies little, function should vary little, right? For every epsilon in which fx is varying by epsilon, there should be delta such that. So there should be concept of nearness. So which points are considered close by? So if I give you a set of points, as such set of points don't tell you which point is close by, as such. Because this is just the way you are writing set, right? If, I mean, people who do network theory, they understand, right? Network, you draw a network, there are lots of n points. But which point is connected to which point is a different thing for you. That's called gluing, right? We were considering this RP2, surface of the sphere, in which opposite points are glued. So this point looks very far, so set of points, this point is very far. But actually they should be put together, they are glued together. So if I give you a set of points, which has number of points, that's not enough. If you want to find continuous function, you should also tell me how far these points are from each other. How far is metric space? But how far is not needed. Some notion of closeness is needed. That's the notion of topology. Which points belong to each other? And that will be given by giving subsets. So we'll discuss it. Anything else? Any other questions? Confusion?
Yeah, yeah. Some confusion is that topological space does not need differentiability concept. One confusion is that it should not be differentiable or it need not.
It can be differentiable.
Okay, so
no,
it
need not be differentiable. I discussed the, in fact, when I gave you invariance of winding number, I never drew a curve with a sharp corner, just habitually.
Yeah.
You don't like drawing such curves. So all the arguments I gave, in which I showed the winding number invariance, were all differentiable curves,
yeah.
Right? And it worked, right?